As government spending comes under increasing scrutiny, the $52 billion a year the nation spends on the State Department and foreign aid faces rising pressure, including from some Republican presidential candidates. But many of the nation's top military commanders and strategists say such spending is critical and must be better integrated into a whole-of-government approach to more economically advance America's security interests. Such spending, they say, is more important as military spending declines. Here to make the case on why smart power is more important today than ever before is retired Admiral James Loy, former Coast Guard Commandant and the Deputy Secretary for Homeland Security. He's now with the Cohen Group Consultancy and the Global Leadership Coalition that advocates for greater coordination between military and civilian agencies called smart power to advance America's security interests. Admiral, welcome back to the show.
Margo, thanks for having me.
So you've long made the case for smart power. Earlier this year, when the Senate was deliberating its budget under the Budget Control Act, they cut $3.5 billion, or proposed cutting $3.5 billion directly from foreign aid. You've now got some presidential candidates who are saying, you know, along with Governor Perry, who say we've got to start from zero and build up. What's the case for smart power? You put a note out on November 18, you and former Marine Commandant Hagee. What's the case you guys are making?
Well, bottom line, the case is both from a common sense as well as a direct economic impact. And economics is really what we're talking about day in and day out around this town and in this country and around the world, frankly. And we'll continue to be that, I think, until we get our act a little bit better together. But the bottom line is where, for example, in Iraq, where this huge investment that has now been made by the military side of the coin, to leave it on the table, so to speak, to the vagaries that might uncover themselves in the aftermath in Iraq without a consistent investment of and a consistent concern for the diplomatic and developmental realities that are part of Iraq in the aftermath of the war is very much on the table. And if you just shift forward another year or two, we'll be talking about the same thing in Afghanistan. So for all of us, the notion is before the military is involved, what are the investments properly to be made that keep bad spots in the world from deteriorating to the point where a U.S. military engagement is required? And then in the aftermath, or even through the course of and the aftermath, how does the State Department and AID, the diplomacy and the developmental end of things, make a contribution to the total U.S. influence envelope around the world?
And there are those strategists who will say that's a very economical way to do it. It's much more expensive to become militarily engaged if you can use development to do it.
Without a doubt.
And yet cuts are coming. How do you prioritize in that environment? Where can you make trade-offs? And what are the areas that you absolutely have to shield?
Well, first, I think we're focusing on the reality that budget cuts are coming. But it's the disproportionate cuts that seem to have been in the mind of either the Senate or the House and different marks, if you will, on various pieces of legislation as it goes by that bother us more than anything else. I mean, this State Department budget is 1% of our federal budget, yet they've disproportionately shouldered about 20% of the cuts that were made, as you described them just a moment ago, in the 2011 process as it went by. So here we are in the 2012 process, attempting to get a budget for the State Department freestanding or in a minibus or in an omnibus bill that closes things out at the end of the year. And if you look at both the House mark and the Senate mark, they're about $5 billion apart. We would certainly like to see the committees that put that together deal constructively with recognizing the fact that disproportionate cuts to this very crucial arm of U.S. influence around the world in a global world, a global marketplace that we have no choice but to engage ourselves in, have to be dealt with constructively.
What are some good ways to prioritize and to stretch each buck that eventually does go into foreign aid?
Well, first of all, I think there is a metrics-associated game plan that lines up those things that have proven to be good, bad, or indifferent. For example, over the course of the last decade or so in Ethiopia, the food assistance program has dramatically dramatically reduced the famine associated with the East Horn of Africa. That's a program that does not deserve to be cut by 30% as proposed by the House mark.
A huge stabilizing influence.
A huge stabilizing influence, which, as I said earlier, deals with those problem spots in a constructive fashion and hopefully negates the requirement for U.S. military engagement somewhere down the road. So that's a simple example, but whether it is those kind of food programs or the developmental stretching that is actually going on at USAID under the current administrator, who's done a really good job of validating and establishing metrics for every nickel that he spends over there, that's the kind of work both in process and a freestanding program that needs to be analyzed very carefully before we make cuts.
We've got a little bit less than 30 seconds. Is this going to require you guys meeting face-to-face with each of the presidential candidates to drive the message home how important this is?
Well, our letter to them and to the president was to point out the rightness of dealing with proportionate cuts associated with the international affairs budget as we deal with everything else across the board. This sad state of affairs in the aftermath of the supercommittee not being able to come to closure only puts more emphasis on the fact that very likely the mandatory cuts now are going to drive another $600 billion worth of cuts in the Department of Defense. The parallel in the Department of State will take those programs to an unacceptable level as well.
Sir, thanks very much. We appreciate it. Up next, a different take.